chapter 55. Psalms chapter number 55. I want to call your attention this morning to this psalm. I don't need to go back and read it, but it's one of the psalms of instruction. Whenever the psalm has that word, it looks like a pencil, but it's permanent, not a stone. Whenever the psalm has that word in the title, it's a psalm of instruction. Let's stand together in reverence for the word of God this morning. And I'm going to read down through verse number 7. And then I'm going to go over to verse number 22. We're going to be preaching in other places in the chapter. But for the sake of time, that will be our reading this morning. David, the Bible says for the chief position on David Hall, and what that means is a string of instruments. I've heard of churches before that preach against stringed instruments, and they've never raised the head on the piano. They have had a bunch of strings under the head on the piano. I didn't say to them, give ear to my prayer, O God, and hide not thyself from my supplication. Attend unto me and hear me. I mourn if I complain and make a noise. Because of the voice of the enemy, because of the oppression of the wicked, for they cast iniquity upon me, and in wrath they hate me. My heart is sore pained within me, and the terrors of death have fallen upon me. I want you to really pay attention to verse 5. Fearfulness, a trembling, have come upon me, and horror has overwhelmed me. I said, oh, that I had wings like a dove, for then would I fly away and be at rest. Lo, then would I wander far off and remain in the wilderness for long. Now let's look at verse number 22 and 23. David, the man after God's own heart, the psalmist said, cast thy burdens upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. But thou, O God, shall bring them down into the pit of destruction. Bloody and deceitful men shall not live out long of their days. But I will trust in thee. You can be seated and pray with us this morning, please. Father, thank you this morning for the reading of the Word of God. Thank you for the truth that we have before us. I pray this morning, our Father, that you would close us in a calling. Help us, our Lord, to be a help to our precious people. Lord, we're grateful this morning for your love, for your mercy. I pray, God, this morning that Jesus would magnify his presence in the service. And God, will you be glory for all you do. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. What I want to talk about this morning in the service is instruction on how to get from fearfulness and trembling to faithfulness and trusting. How do you get from point A to point B? Point A is fearfulness and trembling. I'm reminded of a text over in the epistles that says, perfect love cast about fear. Amen. And so in verse number 5, David said, fearfulness and trembling have come upon me, and horror has overwhelmed me. And then in verse number 22, he said, cast thy burden upon the Lord, and he shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. And then he goes down and he says, O God, thou shalt bring them down to the pit of destruction. Bloody and deceitful men shall not live out half of their days. But, I love that word, Christian, I will trust in thee. David is drawing a distinction between him and the wicked, between God's people of the wicked. David is God's man. David said in another psalm, as a matter of fact, it's right down on the page in my Bible, it's Psalm 56:3. He said, "What time I'm afraid, I will trust in thee." David was a man after God's own heart. Some would say God's people should never be afraid. I will tell you something about it. If a man after God's own heart could be afraid, it's all right for us to come to a place in our lives where we're afraid. I'm thinking of a pastor right now that just recently received devastating news concerning his health. That pastor has a wife. He has a congregation. He has children. He has many, many friends. And beloved, I will promise you that there's a time of cheerfulness and cleanliness in somebody's life. Amen. When things like that come into our lives. And so, I want to just read you a little something this morning that I want to introduce the psalm with. We're talking about going from fearfulness and trembling to faithfulness and trusting. There's a journey that's being taken place here. And what I want to read by way of introduction, I think will lay some groundwork. The psalm describes a time of some kind of rebellion or power struggle against David. David's been defeated. And let me say this, just because any man does what's right, don't mean that there won't be some that will go against him. Honey, nobody ever did right like Jesus did. He did everything right. And yet every time he turned around, there were opposition. There were people that were against him, people that wanted to hurt him. And in the end, desired to kill him and take his life. Amen. So the psalm describes a time of some kind of rebellion or power struggle against David. A key leader in the struggle was a trusted associate who betrayed David. I'll give you that in a little while. The city is dangerous because of the rebellion. And David cries out to God. Most commentators, they fit this psalm to Absalom's rebellion in 2 Samuel. And the trusted associate, his trusted associate, Ahithophel. Parts of the psalm seem to fit Absalom's rebellion, but some parts don't. It's hard to imagine David wishing Absalom to hell when he didn't even wish that he would die. It broke David's heart that Absalom died. And it may be that the events connected with this psalm are unrecorded in the sacred history of the life of David. I believe there are times in the scripture when God leaves things open-ended. So it would fit whatever situation you're in, amen, that brought about a time of fearfulness and trembling. I don't think anybody knows for sure what the thorn in the flesh was for the Apostle Paul. But everybody knows for sure we all got one. Somebody say amen. And what we can know for sure is God's grace is sufficient. God doesn't always, beloved, remove the thorn, but God will provide the grace, amen, to withstand the trial that we're going through. And so I believe it's entirely possible that it's kind of left open-ended. The scripture records what God wanted us to know, but we have got to know, just as in the life of Jesus, in the life of David, we don't know everything that went on in the life of David. But we know what God wants us to know because he put it in the canon of scripture so that we could read it and study it and enjoy it together. There's a journey. The journey starts, I'm going to give you five words this morning. The journey starts with agony. Agony. In verse number 1 down through verse number 4, he's praying. He said, "Hide not thyself from my supplication." I don't know if David understood this, if it was prophetic, and he didn't know it was coming for sure, or maybe he did, but he's taken by inspiration of the Spirit of God. There would be a time in Jesus' agony when God the Father would hide his face as Christ, the Son of God, hung on the cross at Calvary. He said, give ear to my prayer, O God. Hide not myself from my supplication. Attend unto me. Hear me. I mourn in my complaint and make a noise. I'm reminded when I read that scripture, beloved, talking about agony. I'm reminded of going over to the book of Romans where the Bible says, and the Spirit maketh intercession for us with groanings that cannot be uttered. There are times, beloved, when the believer cannot get a word out of his mouth, but the blessed Holy Ghost takes the groaning that's in his heart and carries it before the throne room of God. I'm telling you, beloved, no one ever agonized like Jesus in regard to the Gethsemane to the point that his sweat became a great drop of blood. He was not looking forward, beloved, to taking your sin and my sin in his body. Here's a statement stronger than that. He became sin for us who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. He was not looking forward to being separated from the Father. He was not looking forward to being mocked. But I tell you, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and went on back and sat down at the right hand of God the Father. So when a poor lost sinner come along in 1987 and said, God, be merciful to me. I'm telling you, God can have mercy because God has been applied to the mercy seat. And he could save my never dying soul. I remember the agony that night when I was saved. I remember, beloved, this thing. Let me say this to you. You see yourself going to hell, you'll get confronted about it. Amen. I remember the agony that night. I remember calling on the Lord. I remember begging God, amen, to forgive me. You know what he did? He forgave me. You know what he did? He changed my life. You know what he did? He didn't just empty out the bed. They had a big old bucket full of love, and a big old bucket full of joy, and a big old bucket full of peace. And I'm telling you, God dumped that in my soul, and I've never been the same since. Amen. I'm telling you, beloved, listen, this agony, it begins in agony. The Bible says, weeping in doors for a night, but hallelujah, there's some joy coming in the morning. Thank the Lord. We see the agony because of the voice of the enemy, because of the oppression of the wicked, for they cast iniquity upon me, and in wrath they hate me. My heart is sore pain within me, and the terrors of death are fallen upon me. David said in another place, there is but a step between me and death. I tell you, beloved, listen, the Bible said, don't shut myself with the body. For thou knowest not what another day may bring forth. Thou not a one of us can be assured that we'll step outside those doors today. He said, there's but a step between me and death. So we see the agony. And then I want you to notice this. I use the word alternative. David thought about an alternative to the mess that he was in, the agony that he was in. I'm going to be honest with you this morning. I can stay with me right here. Look at the alternative. He said in verse number 6, oh, that I had wings like a dove. For then I would fly away and be at rest. You know, the dove is a kind of a fearful creature in itself. It's pursued by birds of prey. And they fly swiftly, they fly far, and they go into solitary places. That's what the dove does. He says, how could a man after God's own heart desire an alternative like this just to get out from under the persecution and out from under the agony? Beloved, if we'd be honest, we'd be there too. It'd be a lot easier, amen, to go around the Red Sea than to go through it. Somebody say amen. I believe with all of my heart, beloved, listen, that David is, he's being honest with us here. He said, if I had wings like a dove, I'd fly away. I'd be at rest. He said, though, then I would wander far off and remain in the wilderness. He said, now, Pastor, well, why do you think David would say something like that? Well, let me give you something. He was a shepherd. You know what I believe, Brother John? I believe David was thinking something like this. It was a lot simpler. When I got there, I said, gee, that's all I had to worry about. I said, gee, the Lord is my shepherd. He had a line open to heaven. Amen. He could talk to the Lord and lay down with his feet out there in the wilderness. Honey, it was a lot simpler. Being king was not easy. Amen. I'm telling you, they were after him, walking like a dog. Amen. And we see the agony within David's sense of it all predicted. Wish I could go back. I'll be honest with you. If you do much for God, there'll be times in your life when you wish you could just go back. Wish you could go back to the simpler days. Wish you could go back and to the place, beloved, that where it's just you and him and the Bible and fellowship and praying and it's just sweet. Amen. You know, Pastor, what happens sometimes? I'll tell you what happens. Just like what happened in David's life in this chapter, beloved, we become overwhelmed by the circumstances that are going on around us. Amen. There's fearfulness and there's trembling. I want to give you something here. The Bible says here, I want you to see this. There is opposition in David's life from without. Those, the enemy, he calls them. But I want you to see in verse number 12, he said, if it was not an enemy that reproached me, then could I have borne it. Neither was it he that hated me that did magnify himself against me, then would I have hid myself from him. But he said, but it was thou, a man mine equal, my guide, and mine acquaintance. And he said this, we took sweet counsel together, and we walked into the house of God and captured it. I'm going to make some statements right here, beloved. Listen to me. David is not only facing an enemy that's out there that wants to kill him, but now he's got a familiar friend. And I'm going to say this. He wasn't only a familiar friend, he was a false friend. He said, how can you make such a statement? Here's how. A friend loveth at all times. A friend loveth at all times. A false friend, beloved, when the going gets tough, he gets going. He won't stand with you. Amen. And I'm telling you, beloved, David is facing this not only from without, but now from within. It's breaking his heart. He's thinking about an alternative. I wish I could just get away. But then in verse 15, we see agony, we see all the alternatives. But I wrote in the margin of my Bible the word anger. David is upset about this. He said, let death seize upon them, and let them go down quickly into hell, for wickedness is in their dwellings and among them. He said, Pastor, there ain't no way that a man after God's own heart could be angry. Let me tell you something about my Jesus. He got angry. He said, Pastor, you ain't got no Bible for that. Yes, I do. He went in the temple. They had turned the house of prayer into a den of thieves. Jesus made a service a small horse. Jesus overthrew the table. I'm telling you, beloved, he dumped them. He dumped them. And he drove them. He didn't get up and give a speech and say, would y'all please leave? He drove them out of the temple. He said, this is my father's house. It's a house of prayer. And you've made it a den of thieves. I'm telling you, beloved, the Bible says to be angry and sin not. There is such a thing as a righteous anger. David was angry because of what had happened and what was happening. The fear, the fearfulness, and the trembling is about to turn into faithfulness and trust. I want to tell you how that happens. In verse number 16, David said, as for me, beloved, he said, I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. You know what happens many times? People take it into their own hands. But the Bible says, vengeance is mine. I will repay, saith the Lord. The Bible says, overcome evil with good. Amen. And so hearing the word of God, beloved, David now is not angry, but he's abiding in the Lord. He's getting along with God. He's praying. I will call upon God, and the Lord shall save me. Now listen to me. Listen to me carefully right here. This ain't from now I lay me down to sleep. Look what the Bible says in the next verse. Evening, morning, and at noon will I pray and cry aloud, and he shall hear my voice. Let me say something to you. I'm not a Muslim. I don't believe what Muslims believe. But I tell you what, if we were near as diligent prayer as they are, we'd be better off. Amen. I'm telling you, beloved, you say, Pastor, why did he say evening first? That's when the Jewish day started, in the evening. Evening, he said, evening, morning, and noon will I pray and cry aloud. If the believer is going to get from a place of fearfulness and trembling to a place of faithfulness and trusting, they're going to have to abide in the Lord. Jesus said, abide in me. If my words abide in you and you abide in me, you shall ask what you will, and it shall be done unto you. The psalmist has given us the recipe here for getting out of this place of fearfulness and trouble. By the way, I want to say something before I move on. You know, it's kind of, I'm going to use the word ironic, that David would speak in verse 12, 13, and 14 about his familiar friend. And Brother Jack, that's exactly what he did to Uriah. Just the opposite. David knows what he's talking about. He knows both sides of the coin. Say amen. You tell me, I believe David carried those regrets to his grave. He said, you got Bible for that, but how about this? God told him the sword would never leave his home. Amen. I believe he regretted that sin. And beloved, let me say this. He regretted the cover-up as much as he did the sin. Amen. He regretted it. He regretted it. He sees a believer abiding. Now, I get down to the end of the message. The Bible says here, he hath delivered my soul in pieces in verse 18 from the battle that was against me. For there were men with me. Thank God David wasn't like Paul. Paul said in one place that he was alone. He said, how be it the Lord stood with me. Amen. Here David's got somebody here. David's got some men, beloved, that's on his side. And what a blessing it is to look around and know there's men on your side. He said, God's still here to afflict them. Even he that abideth of old, say, law, because they have no change with them. Therefore, they fear not God. You see, it's about us and them. Really, that's the way it is in the world. There's God's people and the rest of them. Amen. Now, we hope and pray that if you're in the rest of them, that you'll become one of God's people. So you can go to heaven with them, amen? So you can know the peace and the joy and the love that we have in our lives that God has given to us. He says here, he that put forth his hands against us, as be at peace with him, he has broken his covenant. The words of his mouth were smoother than butter. I can't help you. I mean, when I read that this week, as I studied, all I could think about was politicians. Amen. Smoother than butter. I'm going to tell you what, there's one trying to make his way out of California. He's one of the best talkers I've ever heard in my life. Amen. I just wish he had something to say. Smoother than butter. Is that the way it is? Smoother than butter. But war within his heart. His words were softer than oil, yet were they drawn swords. Somebody told me years and years ago, said, Pastor, be careful. This was another old man of God. Now I is one. That old man of God said, Pastor, be careful. I can't tell you, but God knows what I'm talking about. He said, those that pat me on the back the hardest might be carrying the longest time. He said, be careful. David knew that, beloved. He knew that, amen. We need to understand that God is teaching us, instructing us in this scripture, how that we can get from a place of fearfulness and trembling to a place of faithfulness and trusting. I don't know about you. I don't want Jesus to come in the clouds and find me fearful and trembling. The Bible said in the book of 1 John, we could stand before Him with confidence. I'm wondering if God wouldn't just bring us to me to yesterday. There's the captain of my salvation. I've been laughing for you, Lord. I've been talking to you, Lord. I've been telling others about you, Lord. There He is. The King of Kings and the Lord of Kings. God, I think just like that. In a moment, in a twinkling of an eye. What is the answer? That's the last thing you can mention. We saw the agony, the alternative, the anger, the abiding. What is the answer? The answer is this. Cast thy burden upon the Lord. Amen. You know, we went fishing years ago with my grandpa. My grandpa's old school. He didn't have much of an education. He had God on him. And he was, my dad would make the statement, plain English is easily understood. And he knew how to speak plain English. Amen. He's like me, he spoke fluent hillbilly. Amen. My grandpa, he went trout fishing with us. Well, if you go up straight, Branch, about the Damascus, so help me, Brother Junior, the stream is no wider than from me to you. And Grandpa, we get out there on the first day, they stop this trout, you got to wait for 5 minutes to go quick in the water. You know, and Grandpa's out there, we take him with us. And that man over there, where Brother Junior was at, he's trying to fish over here. And Grandpa said, Grandpa told my dad, he said, next time I go, that I'm going to have three parties. He said, one of them's going to have a knock collar and a hood on the end of it, and the other one's going to have a one-inch net. And he said, when that guy over there starts fishing over here, he said, I'm going to hit him about 20 miles with that net. Amen. He said, Pastor, where did that come up in the business? Cast it. You know what we do? We cast our burden on the Lord. And then we got to check our reel before we get to the back door. Reel it back in. Am I right or am I wrong? We cast our burden. And then we just, where is the dead Joe 33? I like an open face myself. I take the face down to see, but I don't know where that comes from. Reel it in, amen. Reel it back in. You know what David did? He come to the place where he could say, Lord, I've got to outlay this victory. I can't take it anymore. And cast his burden upon the Lord. I'll tell you something about Jesus. He's a wonderful burden bearer. He's always listening. He always cares. Pick up a verse to my mind. Just say, thank you, Lord Jesus. Cast it. All your cares upon Him. For He came. Who said that? For you. That's right, Brother David. For He came. For you. The songwriter, Brother Junior, got it right when he said, no one ever cared for me like Jesus. And I say this morning, beloved, no one ever cared for you and I like Jesus. I don't know what your burden is this morning, but the way to get from that position of fearfulness and trembling to faithfulness and trusting, the answer is found in verse 22. Cast thy burden upon the Lord, and He shall sustain thee. He shall never suffer the righteous to be buried. I believe with all of my heart, beloved, that if we understood when a person is born again, when a person is saved by the grace of God, if we understood the foundation that we're standing upon, it's a solid rock. Amen. We don't have to waver with every wind of doctrine. We can stand and have it done on the stand. The wiles of the devil today. The wiles of the devil will fight. There'll be enemies without, there'll be enemies within. And I tell you this, there's a Savior who cares about you, cares about me, cares about your family, cares about my abandonment. Does he tell you, beloved, that cares about our church, that cares about our community? I'll tell you this. We think that faith is a country, but he still cares about our country. Amen. I believe there's a remnant of God's people in America. Amen. A remnant. We love him. They want him to help us. To my people, which we call the Bible. So humble themselves and pray. Seek my faith. You see, that's not just a little now I lay me down to sleep. That's that morning and evening, morning and day. That's a serious business we've got. We've got revival coming up, starting the Sunday night after Easter. But the culture's coming in from Alaska. And we're going to go right into revival that Sunday night. We're going to have communion on Sunday night, Palm Sunday before Easter. There are a lot of great things. We're going to have a sunrise service. God willing. And listen, I'm looking forward to the sunrise service. I'm looking forward to the breakfast and the fellowship. I'm looking forward to the morning service. I'm looking forward to the choir. Really, I go back to watch that over and over and over where the choir sang last Easter Sunday. It was such a blessing. Amen. I mean, watch that again since last Easter. I mean, it blesses my heart. It blesses my heart. The answer is cast our burden upon the Lord. He shall sustain me. He shall never suffer the righteous to be moved. The other side of that coin. Our old God, and remember, he'll take care of the wicked. Shall bring them down into the pit of destruction. Bloody and deceitful men shall not live out half of their days. But I will trust in this. Who are you trusting this morning? If you're going to get to heaven, there's only one you can trust. There's only one that has the ability to get you from earth to heaven. His name is Jesus. His name is Wonderful. His name is Counselor. His name is the Almighty God. His name is the Everlasting Father. His name is Emmanuel. He is the Lamb, the way, the truth, and the life. He's the water of life. He's the bread of life. He's the one, beloved, that is the resurrection of the life. I used to tell the men in prison who couldn't preach against all the Israelites. So God helped me to think the other way to say it. Without faith, I told him, don't do this. I said, you can trust somebody that couldn't pick himself up if he went to me. I'll just pick up your boy. I'm going to trust the one that got himself up. He didn't do that. Amen. If he couldn't help himself, how's he going to help me? Amen. Jesus still finds his bones. He has the Savior. Jesus got up the Savior. Have a perfect day. Let's pray. Father,